So we have a wonderful presentation for you this morning. Our keynote speaker is Kevin Powell. He's focusing on equity in America, a discussion on the educational life opportunities and possibilities for all students. He is the author of 11 books, and he has one of his books here today for us to purchase right after this session. And it's called Barack Obama, Ronald Reagan, and the Ghost of Dr. King. So without further ado, please welcome our keynote speaker, Kevin Powell.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you, sir. I am sick. I apologize. And I really am. I just flew from California. That's how sick I am. I flew from New York, where I'm from, yesterday, and I've been battling something, so I apologize, which is why I have this scarf on and had my hat on when I came in, because I have no hair, and it's cold in here to me. Everywhere is cold. So, but I feel better. How are y'all feeling? How are y'all feeling? How are the folks up there? All right. Why are y'all up there? Just up there. Okay. All right. I'm gonna come up there with y'all after this is over. Is that all right? Okay. I wanna thank Ms. Brown. Thank you so much, Mr. Otep, Dr. Ortiz, this entire community of schools. It's an honor to be a part of this gathering. There's so much on my mind. And I also am glad I actually got here a little tardy, which I apologize for, because it was good to hear some of the comments from people in the audience. And I agree that this is a seriously urgent matter in our country. And I want to get right into this. I was given the topic of equality in America. And, you know, there are so many things happening right now as we approach this Dr. King holiday weekend. I want to say to you all, please check out our organization, BK Nation. Check out the website, bknation.org, bknation.org. On Friday, we're going live with a package called We Have a Dream Too, If Women and Girls Rule the World. We Have a Dream Too, If Women and Girls Rule the World. Because of all the madness happening around the planet, around gender violence and other issues that make it clear that there is not equality in America or on this planet, that's why we're doing this package, because we often hear from the perspective of men around the Dr. King holiday, but we very hear from women and girls. I also want to applaud someone I've known for a few years, Ava DuVernay, who's the director of Selma. The fact that how many of y'all saw the film or should see the film? Ava made it a point to include the women and their names who were active in Selma, not just Dr. King, not just Reverend James Orange and other, you know, dynamic men, but also women. So when we talk about what is happening in America and around the world and equality in America, we also got to talk about all these protests happening around the country. Since y'all were talking about young people, there's been young people all around the country, here in the Bay Area, all the way over to New York City. In fact, we're having another march on Dr. King's birthday this Monday in New York City. Unfortunately, or fortunately, I'll be in another state doing a speech, but young people of all different backgrounds, white, black, Latino, Asian, Native American, straight, and gay, all gathering together, because it's not just a response to Trayvon Martin, it's not just a response to Ferguson, it's not just a response to what happened to Eric Garner, who was chokehold to death, or Oscar Grant, rest in peace, Oscar Grant, rest in peace, Oscar Grant, you know, but it's also a response. In my humble opinion, since we talked about Selma a moment ago, literally in this country, since the Civil Rights Bill was passed in 1964, and the Voting Rights Act, you know, will be 50 years old in March of this year, we know that there's been an entrenched right-wing conservative movement in this country to chip away, to knock down, to destroy, literally, all the little victories that we've gotten for black people, for Latino people, for Asian people, for Native American people, for straight people, for gay people, for disabled people, for all people. Are y'all with me out there?
Yeah, right.
You know, and so when we talk about equality in America, I remember when the Trayvon Martin verdict came down in July of 2013 in New York City. If anyone's from New York, I know Dr. Ortiz is from New York. He's a Boricua brother. We were talking about Spanish Harlem in Brooklyn, where I'm from. You know what I'm saying? That's how we talk in New York. That's how we talk here, too. That's the beauty of our language. It just kind of goes everywhere, right? But when the Trayvon Martin verdict came down and we went to Union Square, I was struck by the diversity of the folks who came out there that day, particularly young people, because they want equality in America. We know when we talk about equality and what's happening on this planet, we can't just focus only on what happened in France. And God bless the souls of those folks who lost their lives at that publication. Am I right, y'all? You know, no form of violence should be acceptable. Am I right? No form of violence should be acceptable. But just like a million people marched in Paris a few days ago, 2,000 people were killed in Nigeria, but you barely hear any mention of it in the mainstream media. Are y'all with me out there? And so if we're talking about equality in America, equality on this planet, it can't just be equality for some people. The equality of responses for some people, it's got to be equality of responses for all people. You know, I wrote a blog about what happened to the two police officers in New York City who were killed. Of course, I said that this is tragic and no one should be celebrating the deaths of any people. Would you all agree with that? All lives do matter, but the outpouring of response to these police officers is very different than the outpouring response to a young man named Makai Gurley. I represented his family. Y'all may not know about him because he's not gotten as much attention as other folks, but he was literally shot in the hallway of a building, a housing project in East New York, Brooklyn, a couple of months ago. His family called me to work on the funeral to help get this man buried with dignity. We literally got no one raising money for this family. Y'all with me out there? And so when we talk about equality, it also has to be about education. What is our response to all these tragedies? Why are some more important than others? When we talk about equality, I was just with Cal State Los Angeles students last week. I love California. I will move here one day, I can guarantee that. So I won't get sick the way I am now. But these students were talking about the curriculum. The curriculum. How come I don't see myself as a Mexican-American or a Nicaraguan-American or a Salvadorian-American? Are y'all with me out there? As a Chinese-American or Filipino-American, as a Vietnamese-American, how come I'm not in the curriculum? Don't my people matter too? The same question I asked when I was in college and I discovered the E-185 section of the library. That's where the black books are, y'all, just for the record, the E-185 section of the library. I went to integrated schools growing up in Jersey City, New Jersey, where I was born and raised. As I said to Dr. Ortiz, I grew up with Puerto Ricans and Italians and Irish brothers and sisters and Jewish brothers and sisters and Polish brothers and sisters. But when I went to school and I was an A student from kindergarten to the 12th grade, I can tell you in my 13 years of public schools in this country, the total amount of black history that I was given might have totaled one or two pages. And I went to the so-called best public schools in Jersey City. You want to know about why people are saying it's such an urgency? Well, and why there's so much madness and violence happening all around the world? If people don't know who they are, are y'all with me out there? If you don't know who you are, if you have no concept that your people are just as important, just as equal as any other people on the planet, it becomes more likely for you to engage in behavior that is destructive to yourself and your immediate community. The violence, we're talking about what's happening in America, the violence is out of control. We're about to celebrate Dr. King's birthday this weekend. Bobby Kennedy, we know, was killed 2 months after Dr. King in June of 1968. Since that time, countless number of people have been killed by gun violence all around this country. Yet, we still have people saying, maybe I should turn off the ringer on my phone. Maybe we still have people saying, it's all right. We demand the right to bear arms. And what communities does it affect most? Actually, all of us. It doesn't matter if you live in suburban America or inner city America at this point. Am I right, you all? It doesn't matter. So the question begs itself, when we're talking about equality in America for me, and we're talking about all these different issues, immigration rights issues, which is, in my opinion, as I'm saying this as an African American, I think immigration rights is one of the major civil rights and human rights issues of this century, I know a lot of folks don't want to agree with that. Some people in my own community, in the black community, don't agree with that. But again, because I grew up with Latinos and Asian brothers and sisters, I feel an empathy with people who may be different than me, but going through the same struggles. If you're paying taxes, if you're working hard, you want to live in this country, you should have the right to live in this country. Am I right, you all? You're not an alien. No. You're a human being. The last thing I'll say before I get to this definition of education, and a lot of folks don't like to talk, when we talk about equality, I was just reading an article on the CNN.com about a funeral. Do y'all know what I'm talking about? A funeral that happened in Colorado where the woman who was being buried just happened to be a lesbian. And the preacher found out, because they had a video created about her kissing her partner, and so they decided they didn't want to have the funeral in his church because they didn't want to show that, quote unquote, in the church. So how are we going to talk about equality in America? We don't have a basic respect for people to love whoever they want to love. Can't even talk about it. What is an education? Let's get to this. As some of you know, I come from a single mother-led household. She has an eighth grade education. My mother grew up in the Jim Crow South, the period that is described in Selma, which again, I think is the best civil rights movie I've ever seen in my life because it's not some Disney-fied interpretation of the civil rights movement. You get it real, am I right, y'all? And she's born in a period where there were signs that said for colors only and for whites only. There was no equality. It was complete separation of the races. In fact, South Africa studied America so closely, that's how apartheid, y'all know what I'm talking about, you know? And my mother had to stop her education. We're talking about equality in America. She's a young black woman in South Carolina in the 1940s and 1950s who has to interrupt her education because she and her three sisters and brother and father and mother are living in a two-room shack. They inherited the poverty from the previous generations. And so how are you going to have equality in America if poverty is being passed from one generation to another like some sort of family tradition? Are y'all with me out there? They were so poor that they sometimes would just eat syrup and it was poured in a bowl and they would pass it around. That was their meal. They were so poor, ladies, y'all know what I'm talking about. Some of y'all do, that the girls had to take turns going to school because there might have been one dress to wear that day. Are y'all with me out there? And so how are we going to talk about equality in America if we're not going to have an honest conversation about systemic racism and systemic sexism and systemic classism that affected people like my mother? How can we even have that conversation? She had no chance to get an education. Y'all who take for granted that you got a bachelor's degree or a master's degree or a PhD or you're about to get your PhD, God bless you, but never become so elitist and arrogant and self-righteous and think that you're better than someone that you forget. Hold on. You forget there are people like my mother and those Latino women and those Asian women and those Native American women who may not have a bachelor's degree or a high school diploma or a master's degree or a PhD, but they scrubbed the floors. They took care of your children. They cooked those meals. And so they got a PhD in life. You know what I mean? In life. That's why when I go to colleges and universities and I speak all over the country, I make it a point not just to speak to the person who's the high position, but I say hello to the secretaries, to the people cleaning the dorms, the folks who serve the meals. Are y'all with me out there? But for the grace of God, there goes me. So when we talk about equality, my mother and her family, the only one that got to graduate from high school was the boy. Sexism, y'all. Let's be real about it. He was the youngest and he was the boy. He got to get his education. The girls, they had to go work. Some of y'all know what I'm talking about. At a certain point, my mother moved up north looking for a better life, just like we came from Latin America or from Europe or from Asia, wherever we came from, looking for a better life. Met my father. Y'all can imagine what happened there. Sexism, y'all. Unfortunately, we talk about equality in America, gentlemen in the room. I know there are good men out there. I know there are good men in this room. But unfortunately, so many of us have swallowed whole the notion of patriarchy, sexism, misogyny, that we don't respect women and girls as our equals. We see them as sexual objects. We see them as someone we can have fun with and play games with. We are not willing to make an emotional and spiritual investment. Instead, we see it as my father saw it. Let me have some sex. And then this woman is left to raise her son on welfare, food stamps, government cheese all by herself with an eighth grade education. You want to talk about equality in America? And my father wasn't poor. He had money, had a property up north, had property down south. But because no love, no real love, no concern for the fact that this woman now has to do this on her own. My mother gave me the gift of learning when I was 3 or 4 years old. She poured everything she knew into me. I don't mean any disrespect to anyone who is speaking at this conference or any of the educational conferences that I speak at around the country, but when the conversation becomes overwhelmed with statistics, becomes overwhelmed with the language of pedagogy in a way that the average person cannot comprehend it, when the conversation moves away from some real personal life lessons like, how did you get your education in spite of all the circumstances? That's when we're losing. I don't mean any disrespect to anyone, but I'm a simple dude. My mother taught me how to read and write and do arithmetic. Do y'all remember that? I'm 3 or 4 years old. She wanted me to learn everything possible that she didn't learn herself. Are you with me out there? I'm growing up again in poverty, with rats and roaches and violence and madness and mayhem everywhere. What child can be equal, quote unquote, in America if she or he grows up in the circumstances? Unless they have a support system called mama or grandmama, or if you're a Latino or Latina, abuela, right? When I got to kindergarten, they did testing. And I don't have a problem with testing because I do think we should see the progress of where our children are at different times. Would you all agree with that? But this overemphasis on testing as opposed to learning, because it's big business to test as opposed to teach, that's the problem in our country. When I was in kindergarten, I tested on a third or fourth grade level in the ghetto. They wanted to skip me, but my mother said, no, I want him to be with his peers. I never missed school, kindergarten through the 12th grade. I'm talking about equality in America and education, unless I got in trouble for fighting, and I was bad, so I did fight. I will admit that. When I got to the fifth or sixth grade, something interesting happened. My mother could no longer help me with my schoolwork. And I was angry at her. I'm like, Mom, how could you, what do you mean you don't know how to do division or multiplication? I didn't know that my mother's education had stopped at adding and subtracting, y'all. I didn't know. She had given me everything that she could give me. And when I talk about education, it also included taking me to the library every Saturday because she just wanted me to be around books. And it wasn't until years later that I realized, and this is the reason why I'm a writer, because of my mother taking me to the library. My mother would sit there in the library and read the newspapers, and she would just let me roam around and read books. When I got to high school, this is all long before the internet where you could just apply for colleges online, I literally wrote away to so many colleges and universities just hoping I could get somewhere. Are y'all with me out there? These are the students that y'all are dealing with, students with my background who come from poverty. Some of us may be A students, some of us may be D students, but I say to all young people, you are a genius, you are a genius, you are a genius, you are a genius, no matter where you come from. Even if you come from special education, your education is special because you are special. Are y'all with me out there? When I got to high school, I went to 3 different high schools. You know, I didn't like the first high school because it was one of those elite high schools, and I didn't feel like, honestly, my self-esteem was low. I didn't feel like I fit into that school. I'm being honest with y'all. So I got myself kicked out of it. I went to another high school. I could relate to that school, but my senior year in high school, the first month in, I had a disagreement with my guidance counselor, a white brother. He looked up where I live. He said, you don't even live in the district. He kicked me out of the school and sent me to the school in my district, which was 99.9999% black and Latino, and considered one of the worst high schools in Jersey City, in the state of New Jersey. At that high school, they had more military recruitment posters than anything for college education. At that high school, there was an overemphasis on these students being athletes and performing and dancing and singing and rapping that they didn't do with education. I had all my applications ready. I applied to 4 or 5 schools. When I was growing up, I mean, this is how limited my worldview was, y'all. I didn't know there was something called scholarships because I grew up in the welfare system. I just knew there's financial aid. I took my applications and my financial aid papers to my guidance counselor at this last high school after I had gone to my mother and said, Ma, I know you might not understand all this, but can you just sign right here by the X? And she did because she knew he's going to go to college. That's how I was raised. part of an education and having equality in America, someone's got to have a vision out there. Am I right, y'all? My mother had an eighth grade education, never set foot on a college campus, but from the time I was 3-4 years old, not only was she telling me how to read and write and all those things, but she was saying, you're going to college, you're going to college, you're going to college. She had expectations for me. And so even how we talk to young people, if you talk to them like they're not geniuses, if you talk down to them as opposed to with them, are y'all with me out there? If you don't let them know that anything is possible, they won't know it. So I knew when I was in high school and I had to do these applications by myself, take the SATs on my own, there was no SAT prep. You just had to do it. Because the life chances for us, poor people, if you can get into college or the military, or you got to get a job somewhere, or you might be out on the streets hustling. It's really that simple. I took my application to this guy's counselor early. Nice woman, white sister. She let my application sit there. Never mailed them off. Something told me, and some of y'all know what I'm talking about. You know that something just talks to you? Yeah. Something said, man, you better go check on your applications. And I went. And I saw, I didn't even wait for her explanation about why she hadn't mailed my applications off. I mailed it off myself. And that's how I got to Rutgers University. And so what I'm getting at, we can't have equality in America if some of the people who call themselves educators are participating in the very racism or sexism or classism that continues to make some people powerful in the country and the rest of us disempowered. It means that every single one of us needs to take a very profound look at ourselves. My guidance counselor, I'm sure she's a good woman and meant no harm, but she was at a school where the lives of black and Latino people was already undervalued. And so I was considered unusual to even want to go to college, and I was considered unusual to hand my applications in early. Are y'all with me out there? But it says something about these people who work in these spaces. If you think there's something wrong with that, that means that you've bought into the racism. You've bought into the sexism. You bought into the classism. That this is all they deserve. No. No. When I got to college, Rutgers University, honestly, I just wanted to go. I went to college because I wanted to make some money. Straight up. Why lie? I don't want to be poor no more. But when I got to college, I discovered I was black. I mean, I knew I was black, but on a whole nother level, I'm African. I'm an African. Wait a minute. You mean to tell me there's this land base called Africa that is the cradle of civilization where we all come from, which means everyone in this room is African? Word. You mean as I was studying the Greeks and Romans, and no disrespect to them, there were African people doing this before they were doing what they were doing? Word. You mean the Pythagorean theorem that I mastered when I won the math award graduating in high school was actually borrowed from someone in Africa? Why is this important, y'all? It's important because if we only are talking about making sure students get to Peralta, that they graduate, that they go to a four-year school, but we don't understand that education is holistic, is everything that shapes and affects them, we're doing those students a great disservice in the state of California and this country. We're doing them a great disservice. It should be the basics, how to read, how to write, how to do arithmetic, how to be a critical thinker. It has to be the basics. I have interns with BK Nation every summer, and it hurts me when half the students who intern with me don't know how to write. And the question I ask them all the time, where happened to your writing skills? When I was growing up, you know, we had grammar classes, and there was a subject and a predicate. They said, nah, they were testing us. They were testing us. So while we're doing all this testing, guess what, y'all? I was in Japan last year on behalf of the United States State Department doing a speaking tour about the I Have a Dream speech 50 years later. This was in 2013. Here are Japanese students, brilliant, just as brilliant as our students here, who not only spoke Japanese, but they were learning English by studying the greatest writers and speeches in American history. And their command of the English language was in a whole different kind of way than us right here. And so I agree with the folks who spoke out there. This is an urgent matter because this should be embarrassing to us. And the worst thing that we can do is put this on young people where it's their fault, it's their hairstyles, it's their tattoos, it's the way they dress. No, it's our responsibility. And my humble opinion, if you are an educator in 2015 in America, I don't care if you're 25, 35, 45, 55, 65. If you're still teaching like it's the 1990s or the 1980s, or the 1970s, if you're still running an institution like it's the 1990s, or the 1980s, or the 1970s, if your educational vision is still like the 1990s, and the 1980s, and the 1970s, you really should retire as soon as possible. Amen. Or have the humility to understand that the role of an educator is to be a student for the rest of your life. And that education is about love. Can y'all say love, y'all? Education is about love. I'm gonna give you an example for a second. We're talking about equality in America. My guidance counselor may not have supported me in the 12th grade, but I had a teacher, God rest her soul, named Mrs. Lillian Williams, my English teacher in the 12th grade. She saw something in me that I didn't even see in myself. She said, this boy can write. And she pushed me to enter a couple of essay contests, and I won both essay contests. Are y'all with me out there? And I was a track runner in high school, and in the state cross country meet, I actually got injured, couldn't even walk. Mrs. Williams came to my house and took me to take my SATs. Are y'all with me out there? Because she understood, this is not about me. This is not about my resume. This is not about my status, my retirement fund. This is about making sure that I multiply myself, because the real responsibility of a leader, including educators, is to create other leaders. Are y'all with me out there? So stop talking about testing, testing, testing. Are you creating leaders out there? Stop giving me statistics. Do you understand? Every single day from somewhere in America, from black kids, white kids, Asian kids, Latino kids, send me emails saying how hurt they are, how wounded they are, how confused they are. They don't know what to do with their lives. Because we've done a piss poor job of educating them and teaching them that an education is about love and your development for the rest of your life. A piss poor job. Dr. King asked a very profound question at the end of his life. Where do we go from here? I just say, number one, everyone in this room, myself included, we need to evaluate or reevaluate, why am I here? Why am I on this planet? And I don't mean any disrespect to anyone, but I actually don't believe in the word retirement. You don't retire, you just die. You know? And so until you physically are no longer here, your spirit and your body and your mind needs to give as much as possible to young people. Yeah, you do. I don't care if they're young people who are formerly incarcerated. I don't care if they're young people who are A students. I don't care if they're young people who were born in this country. I don't care if they're students who were immigrants. I don't care if they're straight young people or gay young people. They are all our young people. Are y'all with me out there? They're all our young people. We cannot continue to treat our young people, young America, like lords of the flies. Y'all remember that book? Just out there by themselves. You know, or remember George Orwell's Animal Farm? Y'all know what I'm talking about. You want to know why there's so much mayhem going on in our communities? Where's the guidance at? I think if you are an educator anyway, you work with young people, yeah. I believe in the foundation of what I was taught around. I'm a writer, so I believe in, understanding and mastering the language. Even when I'm on Twitter and Facebook, I find myself editing my texts and posts. That's just how anyone, a writer, know what I'm talking about, or an English teacher. If I'm an educator, I have a responsibility to know what's going on with technology. I can't tell you how much it turns me off when I meet an educator who says to me, I'm not into technology, I'll never get on social media. I'm like, well, you clearly don't want to have any connection to young people. Because the biggest generation America's ever created since the World War II generation are the millennials. The most diverse, the largest population-wise. We do ourselves a disservice when we disconnect from them. They want help, but they also want love, you know? And I think that we have to give it to them. Now, do we need to hold young people accountable? Oh, yeah. When I talk about equality in America and how we educate and have conversations about education, I've decided young folks come to me and say, I want some help. We have to have some sort of contract in place, you know? If you're coming to me for some advice, you have a responsibility to listen to what I have to say to you. It doesn't mean that I'm right about everything, but I'm going to give you what my accumulated wisdom is over these 40-something years I've been on this planet. Are y'all with me out there? You know? Because we do have to raise it back up to a standard of excellence. As I was listening to you all speak today, including the sister who spoke before me, and I appreciated all the words, one of the things that stuck out to me, one of the things I kept thinking about is, wow, y'all talking about someone named Malcolm Little. Malcolm X. He had eighth grade education. He was in prison for 7 years. When he went to prison, he could barely read his own handwriting. Y'all know what I'm talking about. You know, but there was something, he had something that was able to redeem his life that helped him understand that education, the most important education you can get is self-education. Let me take these tool sets that are being given to me by the community of Peralta, but let me empower myself. This is what we got to figure out, y'all, as we're navigating all these different things that y'all are talking about today, tomorrow, however long this conference goes on. What tool sets am I giving these young people every single year to make sure they can go out into this world? The brother back there asked the question, what are we going to put up here? What are we going to put up here? My challenge to you all is a challenge that I have to a lot of activists who've been protesting Trayvon and all the different things happening in this country. You can't keep talking about the problems if you have no action steps. You can't keep talking about the problems. If you're going to get up here and speak, you better have some action steps. And my action steps for y'all are very simple. One, do you love these young people? Do you love what you do? Number two, are you willing to make a commitment to constantly educating yourself to figure out the best methods to reach young people in 2015? Not on your terms, but you understand long after you are here, they're going to be here. Are y'all with me out here? You know? Are you willing to listen to young people? Are you willing to turn your classroom or whatever space you have into periodically into safe spaces where you ain't talking at all? No one over 30 is speaking at all. Just listen to them and see what they think education is. See what they think equality in America is. Are y'all with me out there? That's what we have to do. Because this whole hierarchy of me just, y'all, us just talking down to young people, that don't work. When I was in high school, I don't remember a single speaker who came to my high school because they all said the same thing. They sounded like, whose teacher, y'all? Charlie Brown's teacher. I also think we need to redefine this word equality. I'm talking about action steps. I'm not really with the word equality because I don't want to be equal to nobody but myself. Just like I'm not with the word minority. I ain't no minority. I'm a person of color. I'm an African. I'm a black person. I'm a human being. I'm not a minority. I don't even know what that is. Because I refuse to accept words that have been given to me by someone else through history, and it becomes a part of my vocabulary. No, I'm saying, you know what? It's not so much I want to be equal to anyone. I want my humanity to be respected everywhere I go, including in so-called institutions for higher learning. And if you respect my humanity, when I go to an English class, you don't just tell me that Chaucer and Shakespeare are the classics. You make sure that Audre Lorde and Toni Morrison are right there with them. You make sure Pablo Neruda is right there with them. You know, if you respect my humanity, then it's not even a question of whether the curriculum should be diverse or not. It's just guaranteed. Are y'all with me? You have the same kind of humanity that a Jewish brother named Howard Zinn had when he was out there in Mississippi and Alabama in the 1960s as a young person organizing and protesting. He was so affected by the Selmas of the South that he said, I'm going to use my degree in history to create a new way of looking at America. And one of the books he created was called The People's History of the United States. Are y'all with me out there? And so I guess in closing, the action steps I'm talking about is what kind of humanity are we going to put forward? Yeah, we should have conversations about testing. Yes, we should have conversations about standards and things like that. But what is it that you're actually doing that is so out of the box, outside the norm, that it will actually capture the imaginations, Lasana Hotep's word, the imagination of young people that they will fall in love with education the way I did? Thank you all so very much. Thank you. Well, I'm pleased. I'm not really worthy of all that, please. I mean, thank you. That's for my mother and Mrs. Lillian Williams and the people who cared. It's not for me. I'm just a regular person. So I was told that we have to have questions. I'm not dismissed yet. And then we're going to sign books outside. Please buy our books, my book. My mom's in Jersey City. She's in a senior building in Jersey City. She's quite happy. She gets everything free now. Free is like one of the best words ever, right? How do you say free in Spanish? Gratis in Spanish, right? Gratis, free. All praise be to God. Thank you. Thank you. So questions, comments, criticism, feedback, pushback? Oh, sorry. Okay. Can you just say it right, nice and loud? Thank you, sir. Yes. Oh, that's exciting. We do a lot of things. One of the things I'm most excited about, we decided to use social media as a tool to educate people. So we have 30-day challenges in April, June, September, November every year. So everyone, y'all, I hope y'all join us. 30 minutes of exercise each day, whatever you love to do, even though no exercise is really easy, but also think about what you eat and drink as well during that time. I'm a vegan, you know, I don't judge anyone, but over the course of my life, I decided I need to shift my diet because I think our communities need to see examples of other ways of living, you know. Particularly, I've seen a lot of educators, activists, scholars burn themselves out with terrible eating habits, no exercise, et cetera. So that's very important to us. We also post a lot of helpful videos and podcasts and things during that time. But we're actually going to start February with a 28-day exercise challenge, so please join us. Hit me on Twitter or Facebook, you'll see the stuff. Sir?
Yes, I just want to say, as a former New Yorker myself,
former New Yorkers.
Well, as a New Yorker myself,
yes,
I want to say that I'm very impressed with your knowledge and your education base and also your experiences. As you spoke about your mother, and you made a statement about the statistics that we so often use as a vehicle to describe how we're doing. So I want to say that in my agreement with you is that we need to do away with the statistics and do more about what we need to do. What can we do?
That's it.
Let's talk to the students, see what their needs are. You know, let's not just talk to them, but let's do something. Let's take an action.
Absolutely.
And provide them the necessary resources that we need so that we can continue to retain these individuals.
That's it.
And we're losing a lot of young African-American minority students, Asian students, and students alike, Hispanics, because our makeup is not such as where it represents that body of students. Mm. So we need to do a better job, in my opinion, in retaining the students that understand the plight of these students.
Okay.
And get them the resources that they need so that we can retain those students. We're losing these students at an alarming rate,
I
think, because we don't provide the necessary tools for them to be successful.
I agree. And, you know, Lasana stepped out, but I've known Lasana since he was at Arizona State University, and he had one of the most innovative programs specifically for black and Latino males that I've ever seen, reaching out to them at the high school level, getting them to Arizona State University, then a support system the entire 4 years until they graduated, and they met on a regular basis. Now, I respectfully disagree if someone says, well, we shouldn't target certain groups of people. Well, if people of color or women or the disabled community or the LGBTQ community have been disenfranchised all these years, that says to me they've been targeted in a certain kind of way. They've been ignored, am I right? And so I think it takes a special effort to make sure that they are not invisible any longer. Are y'all with me out there? You know? And so just like wealthy white males had their own form of affirmative action when they quote unquote founded this country, which we know is stolen from Native American people, that was their affirmative action. Now, I love all people. We're all sisters and brothers, but you're not going to have equality in America until special things are put in place to deal with the special history of exclusion of certain groups of people. Are y'all with me out there? You know? When I was in college, I went to college because of something called the Educational Opportunity Fund, EOF, in New Jersey, Rutgers University. I didn't have any money, But I'm going to tell y'all, from the moment I got to the school, they kept telling us that we were minorities, quote unquote, that we were disadvantaged, quote unquote. I had never heard those words so much in my life until I got to college. And I know that I'm not disadvantaged. In fact, I think there's a great advantage to growing up in the ghetto because you learn how to survive. You know what I'm saying? You can survive anything. If you come from the hood, you know, anyone from the hood knows what I'm talking about. Or if you come from poverty, you know what I'm talking about. But the reality is the Educational Opportunity Fund came about because of the civil rights movement, because of things like Selma. And one of the problems that I have is that people make it seem like we're just trying to do something special for a certain group of people. Well, yeah, what's wrong with that? If you really believe that we're all sisters and brothers, you know what? We got to make sure that everyone can actually sit at the table equally, which means that I need to pay certain attention. Let me flip it a little bit. I'm a man. I'm a heterosexual man, right? And so I understand I have gender privilege in this country. Are y'all with me out there? The ladies know what I'm talking about. And so I know that there's certain things that I will benefit from just because I'm a man that never will happen for women unless I say, you know what, I'm going to check my privilege as a man and understand, Kevin, you also have to have empathy and be an ally to women and girls if you really believe in equality for all people. Are y'all with me out there? This is critical. Otherwise, nothing ever changes.
Okay. Hi. Right over here. I just wanted to say thank you so much for your talk. It really spoke to me. One of the things that I think, just a suggestion that I have, is that when we talk about racism, classism, sexism, we also need to think about ableism, which is discrimination against the disability community, which is, you know, not to use the word minority, but we're one of the largest minorities in the U.S.
Yes, ma'am.
And, you know, I think that that's just something that we always need to keep in mind, of the low expectations that we have of people with disabilities and how that affects their success.
And I hope you heard me say the disabled community a few times in my remarks, but she's right. And if I can just piggyback off of that, when I ran for Congress a couple years ago in New York, one of the groups that I spoke in front of to try to get their endorsement was the disabled community. And they said something to me that I will never forget. Every single one of us is just one accident or illness away from being disabled ourselves. You know, and so, and when I think about the disabled community, I mean, you're talking about people in history who have created and produced things that, I mean, Franklin Roosevelt was in a wheelchair most of his presidency. Stevie Wonder, should I go on? You know, and so Helen Keller, you know, we know little bits and pieces about her, but she was actually a humanitarian. And so thank you for saying that and saying it loudly.
There's someone up there that...
Yeah.
De nada.
I want to thank you for emphasizing the importance of love.
That's right.
We do deserve it. We need to ask our students if they feel loved when they come to our class.
Wow.
If they feel respect, if they feel cared for.
Sí, claro.
If they feel responsibility.
Yo comprendo.
That's why more love is the love that Eric Fromm put forth.
Yes, sir.
Because if they feel it, like you said, your mother, that's what I got from my mother.
See.
So I need my voice.
See.
Love. And that love is giving me the strength to be a human being.
That's right.
That should be the focus of our education.
I agree. Right. Muchas gracias. Señor, hey, ¿cómo se llama? Se llama.
I'm Arriba.
Gracias. Sí, igualmente. Who is next?
Thank you. I wanted to add that I want to challenge all faculty, staff, administrators to really, we all will state that we believe in the capacity of all of our students. We always talk about, you know, student capacity. Sometimes I think we don't think about our own capacity and really focus on the belief in our capacity as well. And when you see, I always have an thing in my mind to connect the dots around here. And when you see the data that was presented earlier saying that, so in basic skills courses in English and math, that African American students are not performing, right? That's what a statement of a chart, right? But I think you have to, if you really believe in student capacity, then the question, it's not that they're not performing. you have to believe in their, if you believe that every student walks in these doors with the capacity to learn, and you see that they're not succeeding, that should be of concern to you.
That's right.
But we have to also all believe in ourselves to make a difference. You have to believe in your own capacity to address that. In whatever way it takes. It might take driving someone, as you said, someone drove you, take your SATs. It takes that extra effort. And so you can't say that they are not performing. I think you should look at how included are they, and to what degree are those students changing and shaping the way that we do things. Because we're not done. It's not for us to sit up here and think about what can we do better. How can we help these students in our own little vacuum? You have to listen to them, as you very well stated. You have to connect with them, and we're not done until they've shaped what their experience is in your classroom. And if your students don't shape what happens in your classroom, you need to look at that. And I challenge each of us, including myself, because even in my own work, I think I've hit roadblocks in terms of really, really including student voice. And I think that those student voices on this campus need to be loud. I encourage those students to stand up, to tell us what's what, to tell us what their experience is, and to shape the experiences of themselves and others that come after them.
That's right. You know, thank you so much for saying that. What is your name, ma'am? What's your name? What's your name? Thank you. Because, you know, she made a point that you made me think about something. I don't think that the student faculty or administrative relationship should be adversarial, but that's what it was for me in college. We were fighting the administration because we felt like they were not listening to us. You know what I mean? And it should be I think education should be cooperative. You teach me some things, there's some things I can learn from you. Of course, I understand if I was a professor of English, I'll give you an example really quickly before we go to the next hand. I've taught English at different points and I realized, you know what? I can't just stand there and say, here's grammar, here's spelling. And so you know what I do with students, young people now? Just write down on a piece of paper, one sheet of paper, just tell your life story. Write about something from your life. Just get it out of your system first, you know? Because they very rarely have the space to speak their minds. When I had interns come in last summer, which was the largest number we ever had, most of the young people said to me, they asked me, well, what are we gonna do this summer? I said, well, whatever you wanna do. They said, we've never had an older adult say to us, we could do whatever we wanna do, that our minds actually matter. There's something wrong with that, y'all. Something wrong with that. Dr. King was only 26 when he led the Montgomery bus boycott. He was a young person. Let's not forget that. Who's next?
Hi, my name is Mei Chen. I am coming from Berkeley City College.
Yes.
And whatever you're talking about in New Jersey, it seems to me it was yesterday. Because I work for New Jersey State Department of Education.
Wow.
And I'm very familiar with the EOP program,
yes.
Bilingual Education Program. Because when I first went there, I was told that EOPS program is really for African American students, and bilingual education is really for Latino, Latinas. And when I look up, I say, how about Asians? And I was told, Asians, you are overrepresented. It just stopped there. And therefore, you know, a lot of times for the Asian students, especially the immigrants, throughout our lives, we have been in this country and trying to find an open door, and therefore we can become part of our society.
Right.
And I really want to emphasize, you know, earlier Linda mentioned that the Asian student Asian population in the Bay Area has been growing, and she also mentioned that the Asian students have a higher transfer or course success rates. And I also want to share with many of you, there have been so many Asian students coming to my office asking me to approve them to take, like, you know, 24 units in one given semester, who could not even barely complete one complete English sentence.
Wow.
So I really want to urge everyone, even when we look at a statistic,
that's
someone
right.
may have success story, but I really urge you to look behind. Therefore, some of us don't have to be criticized throughout their lives by saying, oh, your English pronunciation. It's just, you know, we need to look for how could we educate and help us all. Thank you.
That's right. I mean, and you, talking about these extreme stereotypes, because I think there's an injustice to the Asian community that, you know, somehow y'all are just perfect. No, you know, just like it's just as bad as the brother said, to constantly quote all this negative stuff about Black and Latino young people. I think we gotta take this on the basis of who we're interacting with and what kind of education they're getting. And then that whole question of English, I don't know anyone in America who actually speaks English. We speak Americanese. You know what I mean? I mean, it's you know, and I think that, you know, for me, and this is why I love the language of Spanish, and I hope to learn a couple other languages before I die, I think we should learn as many languages as possible. You know, if you are able to learn English, that's a beautiful thing. But to make someone feel bad because they don't speak English or don't speak it the way you do, that is bigoted thinking, in my opinion. Yes.
A few years ago, I flipped the classroom, and I remember telling some other educators, they just kind of looked at me. So now I'm incorporating hip-hop into my classroom, and I get the same looks. Can you put a bug in our ears?
Yes, sir. I was waiting for that question. I saw the young people out there. I know what they was thinking, like, my man. I think if you're an educator and you have not paid attention to the fact that the dominant youth culture on the planet since 1979, 78 is hip hop, then you have clearly not been properly educated. I think that if you're talking about reaching younger people in this time, you have to incorporate hip hop, social media, technology, anything that they're into. Someone mentioned it, I would ask students straight up, what are you passionate about? What do you love? Dr. Walter Kimbrough, we were talking about action steps. He's the president of Dillard University, Dr. Walter Kimbrough. Look him up. I did a 3-day residency at his school last semester, and Dr. Kimbrough is called, quote unquote, the hip hop president because he incorporates hip hop. He still teaches classes. He's the president of the university, but he teaches classes. So when I went to his class, they were dissecting the lyrics of Lil Wayne and Kendrick Lamar and Nicki Minaj and folks like that. And so he was actually teaching them about the culture and the history of hip hop, you know, and there's a difference between the culture of hip hop and the hip hop industry. I hope we know the difference. You know what I'm saying? If you don't, we can have that conversation at some point. But he also was teaching them how to do critical thinking skills, because with hip hop, you get to talk about race and gender and class and materialism and all those different things. With hip hop, you can say, hey, you know, and Dr. Ortiz knows this coming from New York, African-American, West Indians and Latinos, working class people created hip hop where he was from in Harlem and the Bronx. On the West Coast, Latinos and African-Americans created a parallel energy hip hop. But then the Asian community, you can't talk about hip hop in California without also talking about the Asian community holding it down. Are y'all with me out there? And so, is so many different ways that you can approach hip hop. And I think that anyone who looks down on this brother or anyone else who says, you know what, I'm gonna incorporate hip hop into my classroom, again, do you really love the young people that you claim to be representing? Because even if you don't understand the culture, you have a responsibility to learn it. Why are they into this? You know, and don't be that generation, don't participate in generational dissing. Every generation has experienced this, you know what I'm saying? You know, I'm in my 40s, so when I was in my teens and 20s, the same thing was said about us in the 80s and 90s, you know? Things were said about y'all who were civil rights baby boomer generation. You know what was said about your music and culture, you know, going all the way back to jazz and rock, you know, all of it. So let's be different. And I think that if we're serious about empowering our young people, we gotta use every tool at our disposal to reach them. And they better include hip hop, in my opinion.
Okay, I have my...
I'm just here. Okay, how about her up there? Okay. Yes. I agree. Yes, ma'am. I agree. But she's right. You know, I need to say this. Like, I love all of you. I really do believe all of us are sisters and brothers. I got that from Sonia Sanchez, one of our great writers, that we should see everyone as our sister and brother. You know, we're all human beings here, right? We know there's one human race, but someone decided they're going to create all these divisions with race and gender and class and sexual orientation and ability versus disability, religion, etc. Y'all know what I'm talking about, right? But I also think what she said is critical. She used the word healing. You know, I don't know about y'all, but I can't do this work if I'm not a vegan, if I don't think about what I'm eating, if I don't pray or meditate every day, if I don't practice yoga, I'm a runner, if I don't run, if I don't exercise in some form, if I don't surround myself with people who also are loving and respectful of each other. Are y'all with me out there? You know, I don't believe in this hierarchy thing. You know, even my organization, we don't say my organization, we say our organization, our community. You know, so I do think we need to rethink the language, but healing has got to be a part of it. Because the reality is, y'all, how many of y'all love what you do as educators? Just raise your hand if you love what you do. Well, some folks ain't raising their hands, so that's honest, okay? Someone stood up. Education to me is healing work. But if you're not healed, how are you gonna heal anybody else? Mrs. Lillian Williams, my 12th grade English teacher, again, because she was healed in a certain kind of way, she could see the possibilities in me as a writer. She's the reason why I'm standing here as a writer. So thank you for saying that. Yes, ma'am.
I wanted to say thank you for the promotion of Selma. That scripture says, life you're promised 70+10. So since I'm 70+10+1, Selma has so much good information. And that to not see it is to rob yourself of the many dimensions. It's not just about King. It's not just about the women in the movement. It's not just about crossing Pettus Bridge. It's not just about black and white. It is, you get information about the strategy, why he turned around. You get information about the many elements that were invited to march that second time. I mean, I cried through the whole movement because, like so many, you even get information about his strategy of it being on television. And you can relay that when you in class. And I think in my 70+10+1, the thing that hurts me so much is we say healing, but we're afraid to heal.
Mm.
We have to heal if, in fact, we are educators. We, you know, you hear it. I'm more black than somebody else because you light-skinned and dark-skinned.
Right.
Well, let's talk about Asians all the time, and we really harbor bad feelings about Chinese. We've got to put these things on the table if we're going to heal, because if the three generations behind me don't see that we're going to heal, the self-destruction becomes our fault and not theirs. And we do have to heal. So thank you so much for your message for today.
Thank you. Real quick action steps. I mean, I think we should use popular culture as a teach tool. Y'all remember the film Crash a few years back? Remember that film? I know a lot of educators use that film to talk about race and class issues. I do a lot of work with the Brooklyn Academy of Music back in New York. In the last 6 or 7 months, we have shown with young people, Central Park Five, I'm trying to think of the other film, Four Little Girls. And I know that Selma is going to become a teach tool. So think about the things that are out there that can be used in the classroom. Why not? Why not be bold with it? Videos, Byron Hurt's film, Beyond Beats and Rhymes, which is about hip hop and sexism, very important film, and he's a hip hop head. A lot of hip hop educators have used it. Yes, ma'am. How much time do we have? This is the last question.
Oh, I got the last question.
I'm sorry, I gotta go.
Thank you for your message.
Thank you.
My name is Ramona, I'm from Berkeley City College.
Hey, Miss Ramona.
Hey.
Ramona Butler.
Yeah.
How are you?
Good, I'm glad that you were able to come, and thank you for your message. But I just had a question. With this new generation of students that we are helping, can you speak a little bit about how can we help our students or teach our students or connect with our students if we're afraid of our students?
Yeah.
You know, oftentimes, you know, I'll sit outside and I'll see people walk by that I know work at the college. They don't even look at the students. They don't even say hello to the students. And I'm not penalizing anybody. I'm just saying to connect, you know, we can't be afraid of them. We have to be able to give them the information. We have to be able to see them and let them see us, too.
You know what? Just like I think we should have sessions for students so they can speak freely, I think there needs to be more sessions like that. Whatever campus you come from, y'all need to have honest conversations with each other about love, about healing, about their misgivings or fears, as you said, of young people. I think all that needs to be put on the table and then ask the question, well, why do you feel that way? You know, I mean, I hate to admit it, but well, it's the truth. I think some educators do participate in the stereotypes of young people, you know? And I just think that we have to challenge. We have to be willing to challenge people on that, including folks who are running some of these schools, unfortunately, you know? Because I don't see how we cannot see that probably one of the most, outside of seniors, elders, those over 60, I have much respect for you all because I know I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for them. But outside of the senior population, young people are our most valuable resource in America and on this planet. You know, my assistant was born in the 1990s. She just graduated from New York University. She has never met her father in her lifetime. This young lady graduated from New York University. I want to say that again. She just graduated from New York University, never met her father in her lifetime. I realize I'm probably one of the first responsible grown men that she's ever seen in her life. And so I think every day about my interaction with her. Do you understand what I'm saying? And I make a lot of mistakes, and she'll tell you I make a lot of mistakes. But I also make sure to say, hey, I apologize. I'll take ownership. There are things that I can teach you, but there are things you can teach me about how to relate to you. But it won't happen if we don't have open dialogue. You know what I'm saying? And so, and it won't happen if there's not healing and if there's no love there. You know what I'm saying? And I just think that, you know, some of us have been socialized in this world. We haven't talked about it, but I'm going to bring it back to Dr. King for a second since he talked about it a lot. This whole concept of power. Are y'all with me out there? Power. Dr. King said there's nothing wrong with power if it's rooted in love. I want to take it a step further, and I would say I'm not interested in being, I'm not interested in dominating people. I'm interested in working with people. You know what I'm saying? Like even my assistant and I, she from the first day I said, don't call me boss, we're teammates. I think I got that from Lasana as well. If y'all don't realize how brilliant this brother is, please spend some time with them. We work together. But I think that some of us who are educators, administrators, or professors in classrooms, we automatically see that space as our power base. And if you see that space as your power base, then you come into that space wanting to dominate and control your students, especially if they're younger people. You know what I mean? Which means you really do, as the sister up there said, need to take a look in the mirror. Why are you engaging like that? What are the holes in your own life? What are the holes in your own life going back to your own childhood? What pain and trauma and hurt have you experienced where you feel the need to dis and control and dominate and put down young people over and over again? You feel me? I'm in my 40s now. I'm a grown man. So, like, I've been in spaces where I've been invited to speak, and I watch the older folks just diss young people, and they expect me to co-sign for them. So I get up there, and I'm like, yo, that was whack. Why would you do that? You know what I mean? Especially if a young person comes from a background, it doesn't matter who he or she is. Anyone in here ever had self-esteem problems? Word, both legs, hands up, everything. I still got issues. Why lie, right? And so I think we need to think about how we talk to people. And this is something I've had to learn this myself, man. You know, you don't know where this young person is coming from. And if you're putting out there, you know, this notion, you know, that you have all the truth and all the knowledge and you're the old powerful person and they have no stake in this, you wonder why young people tune you out. You wonder why young people don't want to listen, why they don't even want to come to class, why they might be failing in school. I've been in some school districts in America where they said the young people literally would jump out the window of the school building to get away from their teachers or professors. Imagine that. Now it's hilarious because I could actually picture myself doing that. But on the flip notion, was it Sister Lisa? Where's she at? Was that her name, Lisa? But think about what she was saying. It says something about us if young people are reacting to us in that way that they're so uncomfortable around you as an educator, as an older adult, that they will literally jump out of a window to get away from you. I think we need to check ourselves. Thank you.
Okay, thank you again to our wonderful keynote speaker, Kevin Powell. His books are available for you outside in the foyer if you want to purchase one. Lunch is ready in the Laney Cafeteria. And then we have an exciting afternoon keynote speaker right here in the theater. Thank you.